you for being in Sinister Adventure Guide this afternoon. It's nice to see you. You were here yesterday and you came back today. You are wonderful people for coming back. And we were blessed today with the cooler weather, so I hope you're enjoying it a little bit more. Today, we really have a very special guest. Casper Van Dien is well known for his role as Johnny Rico in the cult film Starship Troopers. He's transcended that star-making performance with a varied career that includes appearances on popular television programs, soap operas, in both big-budget and small-budget films, and voiceover work in animated features and video games. He's also ventured into an acclaimed career as director, which I didn't know before I started doing research into his panel. He's the embodiment of a working actor who has adapted to changes in the business and is always in demand. And we are lucky to have him at Sinister Creature Con this summer. Please welcome the great Casper Van Dien.
Casper Van Dien, like the fourth, and then Casper Van Dien. So we're all named after a girl, though. And Casper, she apparently was an amazing woman, and everybody wanted to name their son and grandson and everything after her because she was so incredible. So I'm Casper's actually a girl.
One of your childhood friends is Robert Sean Leonard.
Yes.
The actor Robert Sean Leonard, the people who remember the Dead Poets Society and the television series House and also Falling Skies.
Yeah, his mom taught me yoga when I was in third grade. That's when I had done yoga. I didn't know I meditate. It kind of helped me a little bit with my ADHD and dyslexic and I don't sleep much. I'm very active and I'm always like this. I'm pretty close to me. You're just like you always act. You're the same. Like, yeah, I don't know how to be any way different unless I'm being a character. And then I'm whatever that character is. But then as soon as the camera starts rolling, I'm back to this. I tried that method shit for a little bit, but you know.
Well, one thing that came through when I was doing research and looking at other interviews with you was everybody just said what a great guy you were.
I paid them so much to say that. I'm dead broke.
The way you were the only person you were to work with. I think it's a terrific legacy to have. So anyway, about Robert and Sean Leonard, just going back for a second, I'm always amazed when there are famous people that somehow find each other before they become famous. Like, there's all these stories about New York actors that group together before they were famous.
Oh yeah, there's so many.
Did you guys ever talk about your dream of becoming an actor? Was that ever?
Not even once.
Oh, wow.
Now, he started doing acting, and I wasn't. I went more the military route. Well, I went to the military school after there. But we used to race go-karts down the street. His brother and then would do this, and the guys, the Renfrew owners that lived near me, they would have me go take the cotter pins out of the tires. So as they would go down the street, right down where they lived, right off of Indian Avenue, which is where I lived, we'd go down their street, and their wheels would always fall off, and you'd always win. I was young. I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know what I was doing, kind of, but I'm not too long. I guess I should be ashamed of that. But we won, so.
Hey,
that's
as long as you win.
Yeah, it's over. Nobody got hurt. But back then when we got hurt, we just brush it off. But they couldn't figure out why their wheels always came off.
Now they know, because they're watching.
Yeah, probably now they know. It was also interesting because he had a pet tarantula. And yeah, I remember them doing the thing. Hey, put your hand in here. And they're like, oh!
Hey, what was the impetus to you telling? You talked about getting into acting was kind of almost a biological thing.
Yes.
So, but what was the impetus to make the move? Because it seems like you have a close-knit family and going out on your own.
Yeah, my family's pretty incredible. My dad's my idol. He's a Navy guy. He's a teacher. But they always they would sing and dance after dinner, and literature was a big thing. And so I was doing a lot of reading. Even though I was dyslexic, I got held back for a bit because I couldn't read. I had to compensate for that, and it became a strength for me. Something that now I can remember my words, but I still am dyslexic, so I have to really concentrate on things, which is difficult for me to be an ADHD. But my family is very, very, they want me to learn art, so I blame it completely on them instead of fucking on an actor. So they can take me off Broadway, and I go kicking and screaming and come back singing and dancing.
So it sounds like you're proud of your success.
It's pretty amazing. My dad is my idol, as I've said a lot. He got me to read the Tarzan books when I was a kid. The Tarzan was his hero. My grandfather made ropes around the house so that he could swing through the forest and trees and almost make it all the way around the house. And so he got me into watching those movies. And when I got to play Tarzan, I got to play my hero's hero. So one of the greatest heroes of my life.
Yeah.
I'm the 20th Tarzan. How many of you met a Tarzan before?
Woo-hoo!
Well, you met other Tarzans? Not very many, but how many of you meet the first Tarzan right here? All right, see, now you can all
give it
a Tarzan.
I was so proud of the fact that I knew the 20th Tarzan. So.
I know that because they're so incredible. They are so fanatical about it. And I love the Tarzan. I love reading the books. I love being a part of it. I love Danton Burroughs, who was the grandson of Edgar Rice Burroughs, who passed away in 2012. But I was friends with him and his lovely wife and his daughters. And he was just such a kind man.
Yeah.
He looked just like his grandfather.
Oh, my gosh.
It was so cool.
Oh, my gosh.
They gave me some of their personal books. Things that happened with my kids.
That's
all November 7th, 1997, and they said I was an overnight success.
When you came out, you had like goals on one night to the
It took a couple years for me to get in there. Yeah, I came out in 89, I did 94, I did 9-1-0, 93-94, and 9-1-0 I did in, and one night that I did in 92, or 93.
The thing that impressed me about those early years too is that you actually, you were doing video game work quite early in
your career. Oh yeah, I played that.
Voice. Was that an interesting game?
I had a lot of
it. Seems like it's prescient because you're seeing the future in some of the actors involved.
I love indie games. I played them a lot and I stopped playing for a while, but I just got into playing Starship Troopers Extermination again. Because I've always wanted that. You know, there's been so many games that have been tributes to Starship Troopers. They're all great and I love them, but I always wanted Starship Troopers because it's like, this should be a game. Now they have Starship Troopers Extermination, which I did voiceover for, but I've been going out playing that game with my daughter. I play as General Johnny Rico, and I just go out there and people are like, wait a minute, is this really you? And I'm like, yeah, let's kill some bugs! And they're like, oh my god, this is great, Rico, we got a game extraction! One time I didn't make it, like, oh, Rico, wait a minute, no, guys, go! I'm having fun. The game comes out October 11th. Right now it's just in a soft release, yeah. But it comes out October 11th when I did the voiceover for it with more lines than that, so if you want a special thing with Rico or even maybe catch me playing the game, and I'll be out there with you guys killing if you want to kill some bugs with me. And they have the carnage coming, which is all the bugs get, as you kill them, they stay there. They don't disappear like most games. And then bugs can fall over and get in, or you can also get on top of them and get a vantage point. You can blow the bugs up, and you go away and you come back, they're still there. So it's like a new technology you have to deal with. You tunnel through them, burn them, nuke them all. It's all the bugs from all five movies, and it's a new one.
So yeah, my grandson's excited about it. He's so entertained about it.
It's so badass. I'm like playing it. I was like, because when I did the movie, we're just shooting at dirt. But now when I'm out there, I'm literally killing bugs. Like I was like you are in the movie. And I'm like, oh, this is exactly what I want. Finally, thank you, God. And they're like, yeah. And then the people are like, you are even more excited than we are. I mean, they're kind of.
Yeah, you were talking about playing, you know, Tarzan, which is this iconic role, and you're gonna be known as playing Tarzan for
the rest of my life. Yeah.
Yeah, the rest of your life. But you also played James Dean.
I did.
An iconic actor, and there haven't been that many people that have pulled that up.
I actually there was a negotiation edition two James Dean movies at the time. One was a $50 million one, and one was a little one. And they auditioned in New York, LA, London, Toronto, Miami, all over. LA, you know, they were auditioning, and I booked both of them. And then the $50 million one said, well, we don't have all the money yet, can you wait? And I spoke to Robert Mitchell at the time, and I said, what do you think? He said, Burton and Mitchell Bush. So I did the smaller one, and the other one got pushed, and they did it late, many years later, 9 years later, with James Franco. Very talented actor. They did it with him, and that was a TV movie, and then he started his career. But I was too old to do that one then, and so if I had waited, I would have been able to play it. So I did get to play James Dean, and it was cool because I did a documentary before that where they interviewed a young actor who was James Dean's life, and they interviewed me, and then I booked the movie. And I booked both movies. And I was like, whoa! And I didn't, you know, I was like, this is amazing! I thought it was going to take off, but then that movie didn't get released for like 5 years because the producers and director were in a legal battle. Kind of fizzled it out from what it was going to be.
You just mentioned the name Robert Mitchell.
I just wrote that out there. Yeah, like that.
Yeah,
slapped that down there just like that.
Golden years in Hollywood. And what was that experience like? It sounds like it was kind of a mentor to you.
Yeah, he was in many ways. He gave me a horse and I learned how to ride. I just did a western called Guns of Redemption. And I got to do all the galloping and everything. I put a picture up on it. And somebody said, God, you know, this picture would be on, it's a paint horse, I love it. Ask me the name of the paint horse.
What's the name of the paint horse?
Paint. Thank you. My horse was Sam. The horse I rode in Sleepy Hollow was Sam. And a horse I rode up in Canada on Outer Limits was called Sam. And an episode called Heart's Desire with Simon Morales. I ride a lot of horses. I'm pretty good on a horse. I got to do all my own stunts. But when I posted a picture of Guns of Redemption, somebody goes, this reminds me of when I listened to the commentary. And Tim Burton said, thank God, Casper Van Dien can really ride. And I was like, oh my God, because I never listened to the commentary, so I didn't know he said this. And I was like, and I did all my horse stunts in Sleepy Hollow. That's all me.
Oh, wow.
horse. My horse is 15 free, which is 15 hands,
yes.
And then and 3 inches. The horse I rode is the Howard's 18 hands.
Oh, geez. Woo!
Original Black Beauty is a thoroughbred. I'm a quarter horse guy. You know, but that was a beast of a beast. But boy, that horse, he knew how to ride.
Hey, Starship Troopers is actually based on the story by a famous son.
Robert Heinlein.
Robert. Is it Heinlein?
Heinlein, yes.
Heinlein. And, but it had kind of a long development history because different circumstances that came up between script and studio and situations like that. When it was finally green-lighted to go, what were the circumstances that led you to doing it?
I auditioned for it. I had read the book when I was 12. Like I said, I grew up reading a lot. Then I reread it again when I was in military school. And I really loved the book. And then when I read the script, I went, my God, how did I understand this satire when I was so young? And then I went back and reread the book as an adult, and I went, oh my God, it's because it's not in the book at all. The satire is completely Ed Neumeier and Paul Verhoeven. They have really dark, sick, perverse sense of humor that I love. And there, some people are like, oh, people are going to be offended about this. And I go, no. People in the military or people that like this are, most of them, some people can get offended by it because it changes so much, but they love to poke fun at themselves and the situations. Like some people are like, oh, the military's going to hate this movie. I go, no, you don't understand. I grew up in a military family. They're going to love this. And they all do. All the Marines that come up to me. I have so many people come up. And I really appreciate it. It's one of the greatest things for me in my whole life. I think you have a question about that for me.
But, yeah, I do. That's okay. You're doing great.
Oh, yeah, I don't want to ruin the question.
No, you're
good. Should we go to it? Can I ask you the question?
Well, just what I was going to ask you was, what part does the military background of the family, what part did that play in the development of your performance?
Oh, 100% that was my military group. I grew up, my dad, after he retired, he would teach in Newport, Rhode Island. Military, and I would be running behind all the cadets in the uniform from age 4 until I went to military school. So they had someone who used to write me, go, remember when you ran behind us and you were a little twerp? And like crawling up the ropes and doing all that stuff. So I think I had a lot of that. And then when I went to military school, of course, that gave me more. And then when we had the privilege of Captain Gail Dye joining a military boot camp with us. He was a Marine, got shot 4 times. And I said, you got shot 4 times, you kept going back. And why did you learn how to duck? People go, how can you say that? They love that. He's a Marine. He's a tough ass. He was running, we were 8,000 feet above sea level running this boot camp in Casper, Wyoming, El Zapago. He's, after a night of heavy drinking in the morning, getting us up early before any of us want to wake up, smoking a cigarette, running backwards at the same pace that we are. And I was like, hey, he's been shot 4 times. He's all older than us. And I'm like, and I didn't drink. And I was in great shape. And I was like, how are you kicking my ass?
He's a Marine. Yeah, he actually had quite a career as a military advisor on films and awesome.
He's amazing. He's amazing. I'm not kidding. He is. He's the real deal.
We were talking before about the satire in Starship Troopers and the fact that when you read the novel, you didn't pick up on the satire.
There's none. It's not a straight, it's a straightforward book.
Right.
With terms of citizenship.
Who else can you pick up on the satire in a movie like some of the critics that gave it bad reviews, which I totally do not understand because I rewatched the movie in preparing for the interview. It's a satire, Paul Verhoeven made it a satire.
100%. It's interesting because unfortunately, the political commentary in that movie is even more relevant today. And I think that's a sad state of affairs of where we're at. One of the brilliant things about Starship Troopers when it came out, it was accepted by both the left and the right. They both saw it as their place. And they both could give arguments why it was their movie. And what it got is people to discuss. And people would have fun discussing it. Now, unfortunately, when you look behind it seems like there's a lot of vitriol and hatred that is made politics not so much fun for me to watch anymore. I used to enjoy it because I liked when people could reach across and shake hands afterwards and do that and be kind to each other. I think we lost a little bit of that common decency that we used to have towards each other. Because I don't really care what anybody is as long as they're kind. And they have their beliefs, we're all entitled to be who we want to be, and as long as we don't try to shove that other shit down anybody else's throat, in my opinion.
Yeah, that's what I'm
saying. I just, you know, and I love even in general. Most people I come to cons, people are like, what do you think about these people that dress up in cons and costumes? And they, what do you think? And I go, it's what I do for a living. I married a cosplayer. I love it more than anything, and they're the kindest people you'll ever meet in your life. They're people, and they can be Republican, Democrat, they can be independent, whatever the hell they want, and they don't care. They're about being kind and being loving to everybody. People come to cons, and it's about enjoying, you know, the experience of being around unique individuals and